It's a Friday and it is Sport Matters right here on Super Screen Television. How well can you express it? It's a weekend. Everybody is raring to go. And Sport is the big talking point when you talk about the weekend, because a lot of games will be coming up. And you can be rest assured that the NPFL is not excluded, just like the EPL or the La Liga, as the season is getting into halftime in some leagues. Some are beginning to wind up. I can assure you that right here on Sport Matters, there's going to be a bumper package this afternoon. We'll be looking at issues that have arisen from the Ghana-Nigerian game. Aisha Fallon, the lead delegation to inspect the Baba Yara Stadium that the Super Eagles and the Black Stars of Ghana will be taking on each other. Still, the controversy of Raw keeps going on. Raw says he could not be influenced when the issue of Ogei Onazi came up severally during his tenure as the head coach. We'll let you know into what PFAN is saying concerning Christopher Justice. He was laid to Mother Earth today. May his soul rest in perfect peace. But the ministry, through the federal government, has done something very noble, and PFAN did ask the ministry to come into the saddle, and that they've actually done. We'll let you into how FIFA has appointed officials to coordinate the Senegal Egypt game, another crucial qualifier. It's on the pipeline. We'll talk about the NPFL is hotting up top games right all over the country. And I can assure you that my darling team is raring to go. You want to ask who it is? I'll let you know as the program proceeds. We'll talk about the Women's League. We'll take you to grassroots. This is a Friday. So when we see grassroots topic, issues, project, we project them the way it's supposed to be, especially when it concerns the young ones coming up and scholarship being awarded to a very notable young footballer by a top sport management. We need to project that. Yes, we'll talk some weightlifting. We'll look at the UEFA Championship. The qualifiers are right in there. The big pack is the game between Real Madrid and Chelsea. We'll look at also the Europa Cup. There are qualifiers and pairing. We'll talk some EPL, we'll talk some La Liga. And as the case may be, athletics is hotting up. I will be taking one of our top colleagues right here in Belgrade on Wednesday. He has assured me he will talk to us on Wednesday, live and direct. So we're getting prepared for that. That as it may, my name is Stephen Princewell Oviesa, and they call me the Duke. I'm not alone this afternoon. As usual, the man in the house, the man who says it the way it is and gets to you with his point in a slicky manner, Joel Wake goes right in here with me. Joel, good afternoon.
Good afternoon, the Duke. Thank God it's Friday, so weekend edition. It's always beautiful to be here.
Yeah, I can see you're dressed in the African
way. I'm dressed for the party.
Okay, can you take me along? I don't drink, I don't eat much. Just a bottle of one soft drink, two big chicken, some plantain and eggs.
Now you call that not much.
Well, it all depends on how you call the bigger food. All right. That's Joel Wakigo for you right in here. I was thinking Sukome will be in here so that we can look at what is really happening to Chelsea. There are bidders who are actually coming in, more bidders, about three of them are coming in, and it's a big talking point. When we get to the EPL section, we'll bring that to your football. Let's start from the home front, where it is really hotting up. Joel, the Ghana-Nigerian game has become a preceding factor in our football. Until both legs are concluded, we'll keep talking about it. Fallon leads the NFF delegation to Baba Yara Stadium.
It's the biggest thing coming out of Nigeria, even Ghana, you know, knowing that there's going to be a big clash. You know, it's a big talking point everywhere. Even the kids are talking about it, market women and everybody. So there is no way Guavon and his team cannot get a ticket for us. It's so good to know.
I love that. There is no way Guavon and his team cannot get a ticket for us.
They just have to get the ticket.
So they're...
With all the preparation so far.
They're mandated.
They have to be. I mean, they ought to get a ticket, because look at Liverpool preparation. If Guavon has been getting a free hand, get whatever player you want to get. You want to fly first class to Ghana, no problem.
Okay, that's why he brought in Onazi.
we'll get to Onazi, we'll talk about it. Anyway, it's a good one to know. Aisha Fallon is leading the team to inspect the turf. It's normal in football. And finally, at least, they've made Kumasi, the venue. Because at some point, we're talking about Benin Republic here. Fine. So it's good knowing it's going to take place in Kumasi.
You know why I'm happy that the game is going to be playing in Kumasi? The Ghanaians are not known to have this flair for traveling for home games outside their shore. And when you look at the pedigree of the Ghanaians and the followership of Ghanaian football, it would have been disastrous to have that game in Benin Republic.
I don't know. At the same time, two rivalries and all that.
Emotional attachment.
Definitely, yeah. But I think FIFA had a committee that looked into that aspect and said, look, let us have it in Ghana, even though it's not in Accra. And I bet if that game has happened in Accra, there would have been an issue of crowd control.
Yes, yes, you yes.
Know? So Kumasi is a better venue, and I'm very sure they have security in place and other amenities. So I mean, it's going to be a good game.
Okay, well, it's going to be a good game considering the rivalry between Ghana and Nigeria over 5 decades, if you ask me. But something quite disturbing to me is the level of preparation by the Super Eagles has been completely weighed down media-wise, and we're focusing on the Ghanaian preparation.
Well, yes, becoming their opponents and all that, because a lot of Nigerians believe with the quality of players we have, it will be a smooth sail for us.
That's the problem.
Yeah, that's what I'm talking about. But now, looking at individual players in Europe and their performance, some had shady performance, and then, but at the same time, if Gabon is still believing one way or the other, I'm going to scale through with the ones he has in the camp, and with a little bit of experiences, you know, I mean, imbibing in that team. But like I said, I've always wished them well, but I just want to believe if Gabon and Amunike, it's a big test for them. If you don't get this ticket, I mean, kiss the national team goodbye.
I don't think so.
Oh, well.
I don't think so. We saw what happened to Gareth Southgate with the Three Lions.
Yeah.
He was given an opportunity. They came back, did pretty well in Euro, and they qualified for the World Cup. For me, I think a test of time. You win some, you lose some.
Yeah. I know this qualification is a big test for Gabon.
Yes, it is. It is.
Yeah, fine. They used the AFCON, you know, like, yeah, fine. They tested him in the AFCON. He did pretty well. He got to the second round.
Very true.
But this is the qualification for the World Cup. This is the big one.
Don't you think the time frame he has, you can't judge him?
Yeah, it's short because Gabon can say, look, I've not played friendly matches to really put these players as a team. So he could be giving that excuse. But all the same, I've always wished them well.
Wishing them well is what we are doing right here on Super Screen TV, right here on the Spot Decks. We want the Super Eagles to go to Accra and spring that momentum of what I've come to believe, element of surprise. Take this Ghanaian Black Stars to the Cleaners. Change the Black Stars to White Stars. Just whitewash them, and we'll be happy to welcome them right there in Abuja. Let's move into something quite interesting. It's been a very topical debate where players who are no longer in the national team suddenly get a call back, and the pedigree and the standard for calling them back has become debatable. Ogeyi Onaze is one player that done it very well for the Super Eagles, but is his era over? That's a big question.
This man is over 30, and when you get to that age, you don't give 100 anymore.
Ronaldo is giving
that's Ronaldo. I don't want to talk about the age issue.
Lewandowski is giving a 200.
even recently, I mean, Ibrahimovic has been called by the Swedish national team to come and give, and it's 41.
Chiellini is giving a 200.
Chiellini and what's his name? The captain,
yeah.
Bonucci. They're even given 70 plus.
Thank you.
So, having Adonazi in that team, I don't know what the coach thought about, you know, both coaches, Eguavon and his colleague, Amunike, bringing in someone that has played active football, in the last couple of years. And from what I saw on the papers, even online, even the club in Saudi Arabia has not even kicked the ball. So why are we bringing this guy? That is a big question. It's a big talking point.
How will you relate the issue of Ogeyi Onaze and that of what's his name now? Odion Ighalo.
For me, I'll have to pick an Ighalo ahead of Odion. Pick an Ighalo ahead of Onaze.
Both of them are both retiring.
Yes, they are. But looking at their stats, Ighalo keeps scoring by the day. He scores in club in Saudi Arabia. He keeps on scoring. He still has this, you know, a little bit of football experience in him. Let me use that word. And for Onaze, he has not even kicked a ball for a long time. So, and his fitness level matters. But right now, I think somehow, some way, we're going to see Onaze. You know why? Because indeed he's injured.
Yes.
Tebow has not kicked the ball for a while. So there's going to be a problem in that midfield.
Yes, we're going to talk about it indeed in the course of the program. But for me, I think his coming in has to do with some certain level of technicality the coach expects he will bring to bear. Fine, he's a very depth player who picks up the ball, who covers for the defense. But I think we shouldn't really focus on Onaze. We should look at the team generally.
Yeah, definitely. We'll focus on Onaze. But now, I'll tell you what. You're as good as your last game. And what was the last game? Many years ago. No matter how you perform in your training, this is a very key game we're talking about. We don't have the time to play series of friendly matches so we can test your fitness levels.
Yes.
Even the doctor said you are fit. But what is important is doing it for 90 minutes or 45 minutes, the time you have. So, to me, I don't want to stay on a Nazi in that game. I'll let these young lads do their thing because they're so energetic. They play with their clubs and all that. So let them go in there, do the magic and get the ticket.
There's something pertinent. The crop of players that will be in Kumasi for the Super Eagles will be the same players who will come back to Nigeria to play the second leg.
Yeah.
Do you think an Ogeyi Onaze is in that team to fortify our strategy if we or we did well. If we didn't do well, or we did well in Kumasi back here in Nigeria. Probably he might not play the first game. He might come in to play the second game.
Yeah, but even if he doesn't play the first game, but he has to train with the team to really see how, you know, compact he is. At the same time, his fitness level and in terms of technique. I know his experience and all that. I don't want to say he's better than what we have, but because you're good as your last game, like yeah. I said. So, but I think with a spice of experience from this guy, with a brief talk, you know, telling the midfielder what to do and all that, we'll really beef up that midfield. Because to me, the midfield is the key part of the game itself. So that is where I think the coaches are concentrating on. You have to talk to these players, let them know how, sometimes defensive or attacking we could be. So I think with the technical government has, it might pull something through.
All right, we're wishing the Super Eagles the very best as they move forward in top gear preparation against the Blasters of Ghana. Perennial rivals, 5 decades is no big joke. If it comes to any category of the team, these two nations are at each other's throat, and we're hoping to see who picks up the ticket. I really wish it's the Super Eagles. I really, really wish it's the Super Eagles. Talking about football, FIFA has appointed NFF officials as general coordinator for the game against Egypt-Senegal. Now, Egypt-Senegal, two key players, two top-notch, teammates, but rivals. We saw them at the Nations Cup.
Yeah.
One did excel. Mm-hmm. Somebody said something. I hope that won't happen.
Yeah.
Let Senegal win the Nations Cup to have consolidation, and Egypt should go to the World Cup. That was that person's opinion, okay. And it did happen. Do you think it will be the reverse case?
No, I don't want to believe that. Right from the very blast of the final of the AFCON, the Senegalese didn't know, look, I want to win the AFCON at the same time, make a mark in the World Cup. No, we're not going to win the World Cup, but we want to make a mark because it's going to be a debut for a lot of players in that World Cup, which they're roaring to go. At the same time, even for Salah too, Salah wants to make a statement. He has won almost everything and all that. So fine, going to the World Cup also is going to be a big boost for, on his CV. So I think the Egyptian national team, they're not playing. They've been, in terms of tactics, doing everything they can, even the Senegalese too. So I don't see, I don't want to talk about the result right now. But
I will talk about the result.
You're going to?
Yes, boldly. I would come back to the impact of FIFA picking up our NFL officials to become coordinator. It's quite impulsive, quite impactful. Yes, yeah. Quite honorable. But the game itself is one of the key games, just like what we have the other 6 key games. Mm-hmm. I'm focusing on Nigeria and Ghana.
Yeah.
I have key interest in the game between Senegal and Egypt. And I think Egypt will be at the World Cup. I just know within the twitcher. You know why?
Yeah.
I'm not going to analyze the statistics, but right. The last people who have their home games have that advantage to do the damage.
Okay, play because you're playing at your home first.
Exactly.
Now, what are you going to do? Are you going to be a defensive or attacking? Now, this is it. The same guys that played in the AFCON final is the same kind of players you're going to play with for the playoff. So, you have to go back and look at that tape of the AFCON final.
Every team.
What did I do wrong?
Every team that has the last game at home will have a better advantage.
Why? Because all you need to do is just defend and score 1 or 2 goals and go out there probably picking
up. In modern day football, when you defend, you add some excessive pressure. But I think I think and I'm feeling it that the Egyptians will be at the World Cup.
Now, taking the key from the AFCON in the game they played, the Egyptians, they weren't defensive. They were all over. The Senegalese in terms of.
You want to take me on?
Yes, I will. Definitely.
Element
I will.
Of surprise.
Okay.
We'll get there. Let's get back to the impact of having our officials as general coordinator. You know, it's been a long while. When we talk about refereeing officials participating in African football, we've always been at the backseat. And I think this is fantastic.
Very, very fantastic. I'm happy this is happening. Nigerians being official. I think on the part of the central referee assistant, probably VAR. And now this is the passageway for our referees to say, look, I have to be at my best, so I can be there in the World Cup. Mm-hmm. Because for God's sake, we've been clamoring about Nigerian referee not even taking part in the AFCON. How much less? The All African Games too. So this is the time I think we have to come out and give what we have. Mm-hmm. So the referee association should do a lot of more training for the referees, courses and everything, so we can even be, compete with other top referees, which is very, very good for us.
All right. We're wishing them the very best, and we ensure that they take whatever they have as Nigerians, which is quite resourceful, into the appointment they've been given as coordinators. Let's talk some the sad news when it came up during the week. A very utility player, fantastic young man, humility personified, if you ask me, Christopher Justice, passed on. And a lot of his teammates who played with him gave serious attributes of how wonderful this guy was off and on the field. And all of a sudden, the players' union that represent all players home and abroad in diaspora or in the domestic league did ask the ministry to do a proper thing by honoring Christopher Justice by giving him a befitting burial. Just a couple of days ago, ₦500,000 was doled out to the family and other goodies for the late Christopher Justices on the offering. So kudos to PFAN for picking up that very bold step, Joel.
This is the first time I've seen a message we passed across to the ministry and they react so swiftly. Good one for PFAN. They're really, doing a yeoman's job at the same time. Letting people know, look, we've come to stay. And this is where PFAN has to come to stay. This is a big step. And at the same time, to the families of Christopher Justice, we only pray God to give them the fortitude to bury the lost. And I spoke to the brother and he told me the burial for today. At the same time, this man is so sad of losing a player like this because I was there in 2002. I didn't go to Japan, but I saw the game. So it's a big loss to us. We have to learn from this. We have to give our players, exactly what they need while they are alive. Because they push themselves up the limit, whether they like it or not. So we have to take our players when they are back home in terms of their health condition and everything. So it's so sad this happening to Nigeria at this point in time.
Let's just stick with PFAN. Being the player's representative, so much is expected from that saddle. And having taken these bold steps to ask the ministry, and the ministry has listened, I think there's a cordial relationship between the authority managing football and the players union also guiding the players in the right direction.
There has to be a cordial relationship. It has to be even more cordial than this because they have to work hand in hand. They are the union controlling the players. And it's not just this. PFAN has a lot of work to do because there have been cries out there from one or two clubs and all that, players not getting paid, not getting their salaries and all that. So they have to really go in deep, send their officials out there, go and see that what's happening to our players, insurance policies, proper remuneration and everything. So PFAN is really doing big. But I just hope the world body, FIFPro, will recognize PFAN and roll out what exactly.
No, in terms of recognition, that has been done. Okay. That's the only player union body in Nigeria.
But you have to see an official press statement from FIFPro.
You need to do certain homework, and that homework has been done, sent to FIFPro, and every other thing requested by FIFPro is on the table.
So, yeah, because if you go online to see the member states and all that, in Nigeria is not there.
So yes, because of the quagmire they had between the factions of different body, that actually came up. But that, as it may, PFAN is still the only players' representative body, and when the time comes for a categorical statement from FIFPro, that will be known to the world. All right, kudos to PFAN for taking that bold step to speak on behalf of a player who did the country pretty proud, very proud. We just hope that wherever he finds himself right now, may his soul rest in perfect peace. We'll go on this quick break. We'll come back. We'll be looking at the NPFL, the NWFL, and we'll talk some grassroots in the next segment of the show. We'll be right back. Joel is still right here with me.